I won't get in your way anymore. I'd love to hand this over to Venky, who's going to take this over into the first session of the program this morning. Thank you very much.
Hi, thanks, Neil. So we start with what the conference is all about, presentations from teachers. In the first session, we have four presentations. The first of them is Sneha Umbalkar from Kalmadi Shamrao High School. Sneha.
Good morning, everyone. I am Sneha Umbalkar from Dr. Kalmadi Shamrao High School, Baner. Under the theme of city and coding, the topic of my presentation is explore artificial intelligence projects using Scratch programming. Today, I will discuss the importance of introducing AI to the young learner. As we all know, we are in the fifth generation of a computer characterized by AI, so it is very essential to make our students aware about new technology. Last year, I have conducted an unplugged activity on face recognition. As we all know, the definition of AI says it's a simulation of a human intelligence, which is processed by the machine. This process includes learning, reasoning, and self-correction. To make this definition understand, I have conducted that activity, which is on face recognition, which I had presented on the same platform, CTIS 2023. Because of that unplugged activity, students have understood the basic and the systematic process behind AI. So they got the encouragement and they came with a various project where they tried to develop machine learning, image recognition, natural language processing in their project, which is a very essential part of AI. Among various projects, one of the notable project is an ocean saver robot. It's actually a simulator which they tried to develop. For this project, they got the inspiration when they have seen a National Geographic documentary on Pacific garbage patch. Littering on beaches makes the ocean polluted. To address this problem, our grade 7 student came with this innovative robot who is trying to collect the trash from the sea and save marine life. In the project demonstration, you can see. Can you please play the video? Fifth slide. In the project demonstration, you can see it was a video. Okay. So, unfortunately, it was very. Yeah, it is because that is very important to see the video, like how the students have did it. Because they trained the robot for what is trash and what is fish. Once the training has been done, and when you will click on the run button where actually simulator has started, and it's automatically identifying, and if it is a trash, then it gives a red color mark and it's trying to discard that. If it's a fish, it gives a green color tick mark and it allows to flow. If any object comes in between, for that if it's not got the training, then it gives a question mark with an aqua color. Means here they are trying to use machine learning. Like as much as training you will give to that machine, that much accuracy you will get it. So at this level, as we all know, Scratch has a lot of limitation for such complex algorithm. But still they used list, user-defined functions, city elements, they used it very correctly to make this project work. Sorry, but it was not working. Many challenges came, like technical, limited data available, resources available. Scratch is not that up to the mark for such complex algorithm. But still, they came of all the obstacles out because of their determination, hard work, their problem-solving skill, the teamwork which they have it in them. Next slide. I really appreciate my students at very early stage. They learned AI technology, at least the basics, and they tried to address this AI and they use this technology and the programming language to solve the real-time issue. At least they started thinking about all the environmental challenges right now which we are facing. With the help of this, they improved their computational thinking, coding skill. They empowered their creativity and problem solving skill. The another project is also very interesting, that is a chat buddy. It is an interactive chatbot which engages the user in a conversation and which provide assistance on the various topics. So here they tried to develop a chatbot. Here also the in the project demonstration, you cannot see. because here very interactive thing has happened, like if you are asking a question, do you like robot? And the students have typed not at all. So it gives a proper response, very like a similar, oh no, I don't know what you are talking about. So like that, a very dynamic thing has happened over here. In this project, they tried to add rock, paper, scissor game also. Over there, the bot is trying to understand the pattern of a player and it gives the response accordingly. At the end, it gives the winning status also. What is its tie? Is it a tie or you win, you lose? So whatever the status it's trying to identify, it gives the response accordingly. Here also students have faced lot of challenges, like the random choices. The user has input, multiple inputs are possible. So how to handle that inputs, that is also a very much challenging thing they have observed or they have experienced over here. But still, they use the decomposition, they break down the problems into different sections. They tested the project multiple times to make it work. They use Scratch features like receive broadcast, random function, list, user-defined function. They pass the parameters very correctly, which is very really very much appreciable at this beginning stage. Sometimes they have taken a help from the community forum also to make this project successful. Because of that hands-on activity, they have understood the basics of natural language processing, which is very important. Their programming and the communication skill has also increased because of this experience while working on this coding project. And as we all know, critical thinking is very much required in such projects. Overall impact of this activity was very good. While working on this AI project using Scratch programming, students helped to develop, they helped the very, very much crucial thing they have developed in their mind, it's a computational thinking, how to think. Because these skills are very much required for problem solving and logical reasoning. Without that, the project won't go ahead. At the same time, when they develop their own project in AI, they try to use their creativity, their innovation thing inside that, and they come up with a very nice output. With the help of this, they got the confidence also for tackle with the real-time issue. And I'm proudly say that these students are really very much ahead in thinking, logical thinking. They have a lot of creative ideas in their mind. In this way, we are trying to make our student prepare for this future learning. We are in the digital era, so we are trying to make them aware about all this technology, and they are implementing it also very nicely so they can make their career in a STEM field. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Neha. Finishing in time. Yeah. So we have time for a couple of questions. Anyone has a... Yeah, you can try playing the video if in the meantime. Yeah, any questions? Yeah.
I have a similar question on this topic, that when we are teaching artificial intelligence to the students, how to introduce the term artificial intelligence itself to the students? It's about how to explain it to them, what we call as artificial intelligence to a grade 7 or a grade 10 students. Thank you.
So good question. I don't know.
So when you will start AI, don't directly tell them the definition of AI. First of all, we have to make them familiar with what exactly AI and how we are using in a day-to-day life. So they are already using it. They are using, like we have seen, WhatsApp has also included Meta AI nowadays. So they all aware about it. So like this, you try to introduce them where we, AI is not something separate now. It's already included in every area or every aspect. It doesn't matter. It's a finance, it's a healthcare, or it's in teaching. Everywhere AI is already present. It's already taken part of it. It's not something very beyond or very, it's not a separate thing is available. So first of all, you have to introduce all these examples to them and then slowly take away, take them to the actual streaming. Then they will understand it more.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, so one more round of appreciation. Yeah, so the next presentation is Netre Kulkarni, Trupti Parde, and Mihir Savai.
First of all, good morning to all of you. I, Netre Kulkarni, along with my co-authors, Trupti Parde, and our alumni from our school, Mihir Savai, we all are here to present our abstract in front of you today. Our topic is teaching basic operations of mathematics through gamification. So when the word gamification is there, let's play a game. So I would like to ask one volunteer to come here and we'll play a game. Can I have somebody? Yeah, so this game requires a gamer, means somebody who's like, I'll call Mihir as a gamer, and she's the volunteer. So please ask your questions. The question is, basically the volunteer has to choose one of the fruits that is over there and keep it in mind, and the gamer is going to identify. So you have certain questions to answer. So I would like to give it to Trupti to have these questions.
So she's a student, right? Standard 2 student. Okay, baby, now tell me. Yeah, keep a fruit in your mind and just choose one fruit from the column. There are 6 columns. Did you choose a fruit?
Yes, ma'am.
You have chosen. Okay, is it in the first column?
Yes, ma'am.
It is there. Yes. Okay, in second?
Yes, ma'am, it is there.
Third?
No, ma'am.
Okay, then fourth column?
No, ma'am.
Then fifth column? Sixth?
No.
So your fruit is in first?
Yes.
Mihir, it is in first. Then?
It is in second.
Second, yes, and?
Ma'am. No, it is not.
Only one and two.
Yes.
So Mihir, can you guess the answer, which fruit she has?
So, was your fruit mango?
Yes.
Wow, right guess.
Okay, this is a small demo of the game. Basically, we wanted to introduce this game to Standard 2, and there's an algorithm behind it. So if the gamer wants to continue, there will be many volunteers. And the algorithm was basically just an addition of all the columns in which the fruit appears. So this we actually took this to Standard 2, and the idea for taking... So implementation was basically, if you see, there are only 6 columns. So the permutation combination of addition would be not more than 10. So the children were introduced to mental maths, adding single digit numbers. They were doing it in their head and answering the questions. So that was the main part. When we introduced this game to Standard 2, the enthusiasm that we could see in the class, the involvement of the children was enormous. Everyone wanted to play the game. Some of them could really guess the algorithm at the back end. So they were calculating at the end. And then we gave this game and they played the game. Then the further on that we did was, we took the same game and went into Standard 6. Now this is a very simple algorithm that they used. But the outcome for Standard 6 was very, very different. So if you, here if you can see a few of them, if you go behind. Here you can see they are just playing the game. The Standard 2 children are playing and enjoying the game. Next, if you go on to the next slide. Yeah, we introduced this game to Standard 6. But the objective of taking this game to Standard 6 was basically to identify, to see whether the children can identify the algorithm quickly. And it was not just this game, but there were two more variations that we also took. And the objective in Standard 2 and objective in Standard 6 was very, very different. There we were trying to give them mental math and communication skill as a main objective, whereas in the higher standards we took them and the emphasis was basically identification of the pattern. So if you play the game two or three or four times, the pattern emerges and we were asking the children to predict the pattern, find the algorithm behind the game. And here I would like to show you, this is another variation of the game. Here if you see, it is addition and division. I don't know whether you can figure this out. So if I consider Mumbai as something in my mind, if I am the volunteer, Mumbai appears in 1 and 3. And if you see in the answer statement, Mumbai appears under the 2 flap. So here addition and division. So it was addition and division by 2 was the algorithm used over here. Can we move on to the next? So this was the game played with the higher grades. And of course, after five or six trials, they were able to identify the algorithm over here. This is a second variation of the game again. Here, the operations were addition and subtraction. So this was a tough one because the children couldn't guess it. We played this game a number of times. So I don't know whether you can identify it. If I look at the highlighted Kerala as the state, and the Kerala appears as answer in under the flap 1. And if you can also do it in your mind how you want to play it. But here the algorithm was, if Kerala is in all the columns, the total comes out to be 10. And Kerala appears under 1. So we did 11, it's a subtraction, 11 minus the total. So that's how the algorithm is used to create this game. And of course, children loved to play this game again. Algorithm was tough to find out. If you go to the next slide, these are the games about 11 minus the addition of the columns, and we wanted to. So this was a tough one to identify. If I go into the observations after we played these games a number of times in different classes, the children were encouraged to make their own games. So I think we have lots and lots of examples where the children have also created games. Overall impact of this particular gamification in mathematics we saw was basically those who were not even fond of mathematics were trying to use the algorithm at the back end of their head, that I want to be the gamer and I want to recognize and I want to predict. So I am the magician, you know, in the play. So I think we triggered that. Of course, a lot of computational thinking, because a pattern emerges only after you put it in place. So there is a lot of logic behind it. And math concepts, I think we also look at it, if I am the one who is playing the game a number of times, there's a lot of reinforcement of that particular operation that is happening, because I am calculating 10 times in my head. So I think that was the impact. Here you can see these are the student stories. This was a game where the logic that the child used was a subtraction, like addition and subtracting 4 from it. And that's how that girl had created a game. The second variation, this girl from Standard 6 used, addition and division, I think she used. Addition and division by 3. So that was one of the games. This was a tough one. A child really took it to a highest level. And there he used permutation, combination and multiplication of columns. So that's how he created this game. So we'll show you some samples of them. So it was completely, we were actually overboard when we saw that, okay, we started with such a simple thing. And when we took it to higher classes, I think sky is the limit to make any kind of game out of it. So if you see the overall impact and possible extension of these games, we could also take this to standard 9 and 10. We thought if we can use mensuration formulas where the R, or like if I just show you an example, it is 2 pi R, if that's a circumference formula. R is the variable. So we are having all the variables that are coming out because each one is predicting and the variables are coming out. So if R becomes the variable and the child is using a formula of 2 pi R, then the child is actually, the reinforcement of those particular formulas, which are very, very important in higher grades. Also, it can be used for using it for two variables. So, one variable could be where the name appears one time And you can also have a question which could be very different. Does that particular thing, what is kept in your mind, appears twice? So accordingly, the gamer can really make those calculations in head, and a lot of mental mathematics, and it can be reinforced again and again. So the overall conclusion that we all thought, and I'm very, very happy that Mihir was involved with us. He's an alumni of the school and also currently in PICT college. So I think, the variations that we found, he was also pretty excited about it. And of course, that really, really helps. So we are actually trying to create critical thinking and computational thinking in terms of mathematical operations and algorithm creation, and the creation of a game is the highest level of computational thinking that we thought. And and the excitement is really pouring. So every day I get a game coming from one student, and they say, "Ma'am, we've made this game." So you know, and they are trying to play it home. And I think the enthusiasm is beyond how I can express, that the kids are loving it. And I think the fever will take over the whole school, I believe. And we'll have lots and lots of games coming. And the fear of mathematics is going away. I think that's the biggest takeaway from all of this. And of course, the conclusions are all over here for you to see. But I think the excitement is tremendous. And we are really so happy that we took this and we are now actually taking it further in all the classes. Thank you so much. If you have any questions.
Thank you. Yeah, one question. Anyone? Yeah.
The descriptions of those algorithms that you said, right? Add these, subtract 11 from the sum.
Yeah.
Or subtract the sum from the 11. Yeah, sorry. So these descriptions are what you are providing, or how the children came up with?
No, actually, we created the games, two or three variations. Yeah, yeah. So we had it in mind that this is the algorithm we are going to use.
I know.
And we played the game, but we asked the children to predict what could be the algorithm behind each answer coming right.
Okay.
So they were actually, when we played it for a number of like 10 times or 20 times, if you play, some children
came up with those ideas, right?
The other games which we showed were their own algorithm. So they created the games.
So how did they express them? So
actually they played it as if I am the magician.
Okay.
So you, so unless they tell what is the algorithm,
you have to keep a logic in your mind.
No. His question is, did the children finally say what the formula is?
Yes. One student in sixth standard, they could make it out. Like 11 minus 10.
If you take difficult algorithms, it's tough to predict.
But did the when the students created the game, did they explicitly say what the formula they are using?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, next is Atul Bondre from School of Scholars, Yavatma. So, 8 minutes for the presentation.
Yes. Good morning, everyone. I am Mr. Atul Bondre from School of Scholar Yavatmal, Maharashtra. I am proud to say that our group is one of the early adopters of CT starting from the year 2019-20. I am delighted to be here today to share with you one interesting topic that blends mathematical concept with computer science. My topic is Exploring Armstrong Numbers, a Fascinating Journey into Mathematical Pattern. For this project, I involve 40 students from Standard 9. This activity aims at exploring Armstrong number, which enhance the computational thinking skills of the students and providing practical insights into algorithm design and programming. Let's dive into the concept of what is Armstrong number. Armstrong number is a number which is equal to sum of its own digit, each raised to the power of total number of digits in that number. For an example, 153 is an Armstrong number. Why? Because if we separate all the digits individually 153 and compute the cube and then sum it up, then it match with the original number 153. So 153 is Armstrong number. But it is not the case with 163, as the answer is 244, which is not matching with original number. So 163 is not an Armstrong number. The main idea behind conduction of this project is to develop computational thinking skills of the student. This is the flowchart which we derive after the systematic question answer sessions with the students. Let's see how we derive this flowchart of deciding whether the given number is Armstrong number or not. First, I ask question to the student. For example, 153 is an Armstrong number, so how we can decompose the number 153 to get the last digit 3 as a remainder? So many students come up with the reply that if we subtract 150 from 153, then the outcome will be 3. But some students said that this solution is specific to 153 only. If we try it with 163 or 179, it will not work. So I channelized the students to think for the universal solution which will work with all the possible numbers. Then one student responded correctly that if we modulo divide the given number by 10, then ultimately last digit will come out as a remainder. So 153 modulo divide 10, it results in 3. So that's how we decompose the last number out of that 153, and that's how we derive the first step from the loop. Then I asked second question to students that how we can decrement the number 153 to 15. Now see, the work with 3 is over, as we have already separated the number. Now I ask student that how we can decrement the given number 153 to 15. Then this time student themselves think in a universal manner that we should find a solution which will be applicable to all the number and not to the specific number like 153 only. So if we floor divide the given number by 10, then the quotient will be 15. That answer came from the student side and that was correct. And that's how we derive the second step from the loop. Then we calculate the cube of separated digit 3 and add it to the variable sum. That's how we complete the three steps of the loop. Now my next question to the students was, what will be the stopping condition for this loop? The loop will keep on repeating. So what will be the possible stopping condition for this loop? Then again, with the systematic question answer sessions and discussion, we came up with the solution. When the given number is decremented to 0, we should stop the loop. Then, so using this loop, we compute the sum. Now we need to compare this sum with the original number. We tried to compare it with the original number and the output was surprisingly saying that 153 is not an Armstrong number. So I asked student what went wrong, what is the wrong in our logic. Then again, after thinking, one student replied that, sir, we are comparing the sum with the original number and original number ultimately decreased to 0 as we repeatedly divided by the power of 10. So I asked them for the possible solution. What can be the possible solution for this flowchart to complete in a proper way? So student replied that we can save the copy of original number to some other variable before entering into the loop. Though the original number decremented to 0, but the copy of that variable still will be intact in some other variable. So we can compare that copy with the sum and then output was right. So then we implement this algorithm through Python program. You can see the slide here where we implement this algorithm. So this exploration activity of Armstrong number significantly enhance the computational thinking skills of our student, especially the skills like algorithmic thinking, decomposition, and recursion. These skills get enhanced. We further challenge them with some more activities like printing all the Armstrong number in the range 1 to 500, reversing the number to decide if the number is palindrome or not, to calculate the sum of individual digits of the number. As students started getting interest in this activity, they also explore that the use of Armstrong number in cryptography, like RSA algorithm is one cryptographic algorithm which uses Armstrong number as its basic principle. So it highlights practical utility of Armstrong number beyond just mathematical curiosity. So here, algorithmic thinking, pattern recognition, and abstraction, these type of concepts came up. As a part of this activity, student also explore the various characteristics and application of Armstrong number, like it is self-descriptive in nature, it is a rare occurrence, symmetry. Armstrong number has its utility in puzzles and cryptographic algorithm, as I already said. So it provides a concrete example how mathematical concepts can be used in day-to-day life scenario. The most important thing is what we get out of this activity. What is the impact of this activity? I thought this activity fostered a deeper understanding of what is computational thinking principles by our student. Also, their debugging and testing proficiency get enhanced, and definitely this activity concretely applied how we can interlink mathematical concepts with programming. Undoubtedly, this project of exploration of Armstrong number enhanced the computational thinking skills such as pattern recognition, algorithmic thinking, decomposition, and abstraction. So this activity definitely shown a significant impact on our student as far as computational thinking skill is concerned. Thank you for your attention. I am ready for any questions from your side.
Thank you very much. Nice talk. Yeah, questions?
Sir, in the flow chart, could you please put it on the screen, the flow chart?
Yes. Slide number four.
On this flow chart, that suppose the number is 1634, then students need to first determine the number of the digits. So yes. How the students are determining the value of small d, that will be 4 in case of, if I take 1634 as the number.
Yes, sir, I agree. Here, D is for a number of digits. So for that, if we think, I can understand that it is not mentioned here. But for that, we can use the length function, where we can, as we know in Python, using input function, we can get a value in the form of string, we calculate the length, and then we can convert it into the number. That can be done.
Any other questions? So let's thank the speaker once again.
Thank you.
Now for the last talk of this session, Manisha Girolkar and Gauri Joshi from Shamrao Kalmadi, Dr. Kalmadi Shamrao High School.
Good morning, everyone. I am Manisha Girolkar and my friend Gauri Joshi. We are from Dr. Kalmadi Shamrao High School, Ganeshnagar, Pune. Our school was the pilot school for adapting CS Pathshala curriculum in 2016. We are incorporating all the CT activities in our computer and ATL syllabus. Even our language and math science teachers are also trying to inculcate CT skills in their teaching learning process. Now about today's topic. We live in the digital world, and cybersecurity is one of the biggest concerns. we read the news like this every day. So to make our students aware of the potential risk in the digital world and make them ready for how to protect their data, their devices and themselves from the threats, we have incorporated this cyber security lesson from standard 5 to standard 10. Now for standard 7, we have taken importance of digital locking system. You know that this topic is theoretical, but we tried to include city activities. The first activity was creating the password, and second was innovating new digital locking system. The objective of this activity, the first one is providing the opportunity is for computational thinking, and the second one, very important, is we have used city as differentiated element. Like we know that in the class of 40, there are 5 to 10 students who are having high ability, and they are always wanting the challenge and they will go ahead. So for them, I think city is the best tool. Then to get the innovative ideas from the student, we have kept open-ended questions. Even though our activity is structured, we haven't set any fixed output. And we did the variation at every stage to get the exciting outputs and from the original output. Because the process is important, not the output. So now Gauri will take you through the process of this activity.
So the first important step in our activity was to have a discussion regarding the passwords. We all know that we live in a digital era where we have passwords for our devices. So here we discussed with the students how to keep passwords, and students also shared their experiences that their parents usually prefer to have their names, surnames, date of birth, special characters are as passwords which are easy to remember. So at this point we asked them a question, is it safe to have such weak passwords? Or is it safe to have this password? So the answer from the students were no. So here they realized the need of strong passwords. So our discussion led to the question, how can we create a strong password? Here I gave them the example. I can create a code of my name. Say for example, G5J5@1234. So I can put my set of rules and design a password. So here we posed a challenge to the students that can you create an algorithm to generate a strong password, and this created a wave of enthusiasm in the class. They were busy applying their own rules to design strong passwords, and there was a lot of excitement. Everybody wanted to share, and to our surprise, 10 to 15 students came up with their own set of algorithms. So here you can see one of our students has written the algorithm where he has used his own set of rules to generate the password, and to make it a bit difficult, he has converted the letters to numbers and numbers to letters. So the next task the students ask, after algorithm is done, what could we do next, ma'am? So we extended our activity, and as per the students' response, at the spot we asked them, can you write a program out of this algorithm in any language you want? So here you can see a student have written the program for this particular algorithm. They have used the proverb or name or date of birth, and the password is generated. Even though this looks easy, but they have used Scratch programming and they have used different functions to code this. The second important part of our system was locking system. We all know we have different locks on our devices like face expression, fingerprints, QR codes. So here we asked student a question, do you find any loopholes in this locking system? So of course the students shared their experiences and they said yes. So here we triggered a question, are there any ways to design an innovative locking system of your own? So we discussed and brainstormed. So they gave certain ideas like voice recognition could be one, asking a specific question to unlock the device, tapping on a phone for a particular pattern, expression and gesture. So out of this listed names, we took only two activities. One of the activity was to unlock the device using the expression. So a user sets a particular expression, and if it matches, then the device is going to get unlocked. And the other one was gesture detection. So user has to use a specific hand movement. The speed of that gesture is recorded, and if it is matches, then the system gets unlocked. So here we would like to show you the demo. Okay, we will see the video later. Or is it possible? Oh, but okay. Just take forward so that they can see the. So they are demonstrating their work. So here, first of all, they are setting the password and expression. And while unlocking, the expression is matched, then the device will unlock. So as you have seen, now I will go for the impact slide. As you have seen, that throughout the activities, students are engaged, and they are not just a passive learner, but they were engaged in designing, coding, and implementing their solution. There were some moments of disappointment when their code didn't run, when they had exciting idea but they couldn't implement those ideas, but still in the process they learn how to automate the process, and they also realize. Even though we are using these small automations, how much logic and efforts are needed. So I can say they reach to the highest level of Bloom's taxonomy. Like, they have started with understanding the system, understanding the digital locking system, but they reach to creation, application and creation of the new locking system. So I can say that they have shifted from mere user of technology to the creator of technology. The major takeaways for us as teachers, that we should give the minimal instructions, because our role now is changed from teachers to facilitator, and small learning triggers are enough to get the ideas from them. Then keep the open-ended questions and engage students in the higher order thinking. Now you know, with the AI modules like ChatGPT, DALL-E, everything has become so easy. Earlier we used to think a lot, but everything is in very easy. So it's our responsibility to really, as sir said, we have to keep them one step ahead of AI. So we have to give higher order thinking tasks. Then variations are needed. We cannot put the fixed output for any activity. We should welcome the unexpected output from our young children. Thank you very much. I really thank CS Pathshala for giving this platform. I thank my mentor, Venkatesh sir, and of course, my colleagues and my students. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Questions? One question. Yeah.
I have a question. How long did this whole project take, and how did you organize your timetable?
So,
as a math teacher, or
we are the computer teachers, and actually these activities are not as a part of syllabus. They are extended activities, and specially designed for the gifted students. So we have given at least, I think in a week we have done this, and they have taken, if we count the total period, so 2 to 3 hours they have taken for to design all these things. And for this, for expression recognition, they explore picto blocks on their own and they use. So many, on many incidences, they have learned, there was self-learning, and they have come up with their own ideas.
Greetings. Hello. Madam, I wanted to ask that, as you have said that children were able to unlock or to decide a lock with the gestures as well. So ma'am, how did you teach students the algorithm or the logic behind the gesture setting password? Because me being a computer graduate, ma'am, I know that it is quite difficult.
Yes.
To set this gesture password as well, because it requires a lot of computer vision and a lot of those things as well.
Yes.
So how did children come up with this, or like how did you teach children the logic behind it, that okay, every pixel has to be matched, or every section of the image has to be matched with this?
Yes, that is another part. But now they have the exciting idea that expression detection should be done. So they explored Scratch, it was not possible for them. So they found out in PictoBlocks there is expression, it is the AI tool. So teaching how AI tool work is another part. So we have to design another activity for that. But for now, for this particular activity, they have used a ready-made AI tool, which is PictoBlocks. But they explore that tool. That is was also not the part of our regular curriculum. They explore and they completed the task. Because they have so many ideas, so there is limitation in Scratch. So they couldn't do. But these two things they could do, they have done motion sensor thing and the expression detection thing. And they have kept two locks, like after expression, you could have seen the demo. So expression and password, both the locks they have kept.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks once again. Yeah, now, certificates. Yeah, all, everyone come over. Sneha Barkar. Trupti. Trupti.
Switch one, sir, but.
Atul. Gauri, they are not. Gauri, they are depriving you.
Okay. Which switch is what? Like, you know, tell me.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Now we break for 1 second. We have an announcement.
Two announcements. One, we request all of you to be in the hall by 10:45 so that we start our sessions on time. Second, anybody's got a video to be...
I think I'm audible. Anybody's got a video
to... Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. Two announcements. First, all of us will have to be back here sharp 10:45 because we have the invited speakers thing at 11. Second, anybody's got a video to be played, kindly meet us during the lunch break so that we can test it out.
Also, registration will continue in the lunch break. Please don't go to registration desk now, those who haven't registered, okay? Just have chai and come back. Yeah?
They tell you on students not to open registration desk. Thank you.